evening, everyone. I, Dr. Aarti Hira, welcome you all to today's session on mucormycosis in current scenario, organized by SSTC and PG Examination Forum. So this webinar is conducted under PG Examination Forum, which is a brainchild of Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir. It's a unique platform for postgraduates to interact with each other and eminent teachers and get guidance for various exam preparation. So let me introduce today's chairpersons, Dr. Ashok Rai, sir. So he is a National Vice President, Indian Medical Association. He is National IMA COVID Task Force member. He is Conveyor State IMA COVID Task Force, and he is President of Indian Academy of Pediatric UP. He is editor of various books like Pediatric Infectious Diseases, textbooks of pediatrics, and he is editor of Grand Round in Infectious Diseases. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aarti. And first of all, I welcome you all in this much needed webinar on mucormycosis. I'm really thankful to Dr. Deepak Mishra for inviting me to this prestigious webinar. And also to Dr. Satanshu Mathur and Dr. Aarti Deka for moderating this session. As you know, the mucormycosis is a life-threatening infection. It's caused by mucorales, basically. And Rhizopus oryzae is the most common organism which has been isolated, I think, more than in 70% patients of mucormycosis, as per literature. In India, more than 6,500 cases have been reported till today, and more than 600 cases we have seen in Uttar Pradesh, and with 219 deaths in India till date. As you know, that it occurs in patients who are immunocompromised, everybody knows. But unfortunately, despite the vigorous therapy, the overall mortality rate is very high. It is more than 50%. And it is more than 100% if the approach is nearly 100% among the patients with disseminated disease, whenever there is a dissemination of disease, are patients with persistent neutropenia. What we are discussing so much on the what are the causes. In the first wave, I think only 35 cases were detected of this mucormycosis. But in this phase, so many cases have come. What are the causes? The main causes are which have been found till date, and still a speculation is going on. One is the uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, which have been told by everybody. Then second is prolonged ICU stay. And prolonged ICU stay means if there is a reused face mask for oxygen delivery, reused tubings, and unhygienically prepared swab sticks. Then organ or bone marrow transplant patients, they are in immunosuppression. Then patients with neutropenia. And one more important cause is desferrioxamine therapy in patients receiving hemodialysis. So these are the few of the factors which can lead to mucormycosis. Now, I will just share a data that this clinical and experimental data which demonstrates that individuals who lack phagocytes or phagocytic functions are a high risk of developing this mucormycosis. Let me take an example that patients with severe neutropenia are at increasing risk for developing this mucormycosis. In contrast to patients with AIDS, if you see the AIDS patient, this is also a immunodeficient patient, but do not seem to be increased risk for developing this mucormycosis. So this finding suggests that neutrophils play a major role rather than T lymphocytes, which are critical for inhibiting fungal spore proliferation. Then, in the cases of diabetes, basically in diabetic ketoacidosis, what happens, there is a hyperglycemia along with low pH. In this condition, these phagocytes are dysfunctional. And these phagocytes have impaired chemotaxis and defective intracellular killing by both oxidative and non-oxidative mechanism. So this infection causes an extensive angioinvasion. That is the main cause that results in vessel thrombosis and subsequent tissue necrosis. This is the main reason. And this angioinvasion contributes to the capacity of this organism to hematogenously disseminate to other parts of the body. Friends, the use of steroids, monoclonal antibodies, the broad spectrum antibiotics for management of COVID-19 illness has increased the chances of new onset fungal infection or exacerbate if there are pre-existing fungal infections. Indian Medical Association, as far as concerned, has issued a guidelines regarding mucormycosis yesterday only, and we are starting a series of webinar in the entire country to educate our doctor colleagues. So friends, I will not take much time, and with these few words, I will hand over this to Dr. Aarti.
So thank you so much, sir. So continuing further, let me introduce our next chairman, Ikki Grover sir, who is chairman of Vision Eye Center, New Delhi. He is an ophthalmologist of international repute. He is also head of Department of Ophthalmology at Sir Gangaram Hospital. He has been awarded Padma Shri by President of India in recognition of his distinguished services in the field of eye care to the country. He is a past president of AIOS and is pioneer in phacoemulsification and oculoplastic surgery. He is president of South Asian Association of Oculoplastic, Reconstructive and Oculofacial Aesthetic Surgery. We welcome you, sir.
To add, Aarti, doctor, we all know Dr. Grover, sir, as a renowned oculoplastic surgeon, not India, but at international level. And we have, many of us have learned from him many the oculoplasty. So we are lucky to have, and Dr. Ashok Rai, sir, we will request you to stay with us. We'll have a discussion after this meeting. And we are, your valuable session will always be welcome this, because you are holding a post where your words are have really valued.
Thank you, Dr. Satanshu. Thank you, Dr. Aarti.
Aarti, Dr. Anubhav Santosh ka remove karo.
So I thought I
would like to just take a minute to thank both of you for having organized this program, and particularly to Deepak for having organized this at a time when the ophthalmic community is inundated with these cases. It's a hard time, especially for the oculoplastic surgeons. Just as we were discussing, Dr. Manish has not had his lunch today, our ENT surgeon in Gangaram, because there are about 80 cases admitted and he's doing about 15 surgeries a day. And same is true for our oculoplastic team, where we are doing excentrations at a huge number. And there is a deluge at a time when the medicines are short, when the going could not be tougher than this. So it's timely that we have such experienced and such stalwarts in the field to discuss it. Santosh, who's given such wonderful guidelines in Indian Journal on based on a review for the management. And we have Dr. Manish as the ENT surgeon. We have the neurosurgeons and the team of academic Dr. Shubha with us to discuss this, and Dr. Ravi Shankar Prasad to discuss the neurological aspect. So it's a wonderful team. We hope we'll have a very nice discussion. Look forward to the program. Thank you again for organizing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Dr. and Aarti, kindly finish all the speakers' introduction first.
Sure, sir. I'll do that. So Dr. Santosh Honawar, sir, who needs no introduction, he is currently the editor of Indian Journal of Ophthalmology and Indian Journal of Ophthalmology Case Reports. He's director of Medical Services Center for Sight Group. He is director of Department of Ocular Oncology and Oculoplasty at Center for Sight, Hyderabad. He's director of National Retinoblastoma Foundation. The Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, the apex agency of the Government of India for Scientific Research, awarded him the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology, one of the highest Indian service awards for his contribution to medical sciences in 2009. Dr. Honawar is the only Indian ophthalmologist to receive the Lifetime Achievement Award by the American Academy of Ophthalmology and Honorary Fellowship of Royal College of Ophthalmologists, London, UK. We are glad to have you today with us, sir. Moving on to our next speaker, Dr. Shubha Ma'am. She is currently working at Government Medical College, Aurangabad. She's on editorial board member of International Journal of Ocular Oncology and Oculoplasty. She is a popular teacher amongst many students. She is an active Lions Club president and district chairperson site. Other than this, she is an artist who loves watercolor painting. Welcome, ma'am. So then we have with us Dr. Ravi Shankar Prasad, sir, who is head of Department of Urology, BHU Varanasi. Then we have with us Dr. Manish, sir, who is senior ENT consultant at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. So moving on to further team members, I'll introduce quickly my co-moderators for this session today. Dr. Satanshu Mathur, sir, who owns a high-tech eye institute and laser center in Kashipur, Uttarakhand. He is a chairperson of scientific committee of Association of Community Ophthalmologists, ECOIN India. He is a co-founder of PG Examination Forum. He is secretary of North Zone Ophthalmological Society and Uttarakhand State Ophthalmological Society. Welcome, sir. Then we have Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir, our favorite. He is faculty at Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, BHU, Varanasi. He is a founder and admin of PG Examination Forum. He is a chairperson of Scientific Committee, Uttar Pradesh State Ophthalmic Society. He is a national conveyor, SST. Welcome, sir. Last but not the least, I welcome all the special invitees today for this session. Dr. Malhotra, Dr. Surbhi Gupta, Dr. Abhishek Sachdeva, Dr. Surbhi Priyadarshini, and Dr. Atul. Welcome all of you. So without further delay, over to you, Deepak, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Arti. Now I will invite Dr. Santosh Anwar, sir, who is my mentor too in each and every field. Sir, I am no longer between you and your audience. Please, sir.
Thank you so much, Deepak.
Santosh,
I think it's a wonderful effort by you to organize this at such a short notice. I'll be speaking about mucormycosis in the era of COVID-19 and try to give an overview and also propose the stage-based management approach. This was in February that we published this very brief case report. This was just a collection of 6 cases between Hyderabad and Mumbai. That's all we had. This was the tapering end of the first wave. Second wave had not begun yet, and our OPDs were full of cataracts and other stuff, you know, general cases. But yet there were patients who were trickling in at that time. So we got a little alarmed as to why is this happening. And those patients were progressing very rapidly. So this was all from the first wave. And we were at that time never aware that we would have such a deluge of cases within the next 2 or 3 months. So there was a fire that was smoldering at that time. Now it's become a very big kind of a deluge. Now, why does mucor inhibit the viral land? So some of this was already mentioned. There is decreased immunity, which is very well known. There are associated comorbidities with such as diabetes, obesity, which are common to both mucormycosis as well as COVID-19. There is loss of pulmonary function or decompensated pulmonary function that can act as an adverse mechanism. Use of immunosuppressives such as corticosteroids and tocilizumab obviously will serve as risk factors. And it is also found that it is more common among patients who have a severe disease who require mechanical ventilation and prolonged supplemental oxygen. We already knew that COVID has a risk of secondary infection that was up to 8 to 10%. Secondary infection could be bacterial or fungal, and bacterial secondary infection used to occur in the early phase of COVID disease, whereas secondary fungal infection used to occur in the middle stage and even following resolution of COVID-19. So this was already known, and the incidence of secondary fungal infection was very low, but the mortality was higher, that was already known. So this was all from the international literature. When we gather all that together, we find that mucormycosis was reported even in the first wave in many of the Western countries and countries like Iran, and the mortality was high, it was noted, and a delayed manifestation even following resolution of COVID was also noted. That is all in the literature. Now, how does mucor infect a patient who has COVID? There are 2 mechanisms that are proposed. One is endogenous source and the second is exogenous source. Why endogenous? Because mucorales are commensals in the GIT, that is known. But mucorales are also found in the nose and nasopharynx. This is a well-established thing. In COVID, there is breach in mucosal immunity of mucosal barrier. Mucosal protective function is breached. The function of the mucosa being breached and prolonged breach being a part and parcel of the pathogenesis of COVID-19, the commensals in the nose and nasopharynx can penetrate and proliferate. That is one source. Second proposed mechanism is that since there is angioinvasion and necrosis of tissue, mucormycosis can secondly infect the areas which are already necrosed. The second is an exogenous source. The patient has already a bad mucosal immunity and mucus is everywhere. In every breath you take, you inhale mucus spores and that can infect a predisposed individual. This is the literature that I was talking about. It is proven well beyond doubt that there is impaired mucosal immunity at the point of entry and point of proliferation in COVID-19. This is already very well established fact. It is also established that mucosal immunity is the earliest to be breached. In fact, that is the mechanism that COVID-19 infection or coronavirus infection follows. It breaches the mucosal immunity and then it enters at the point of entry, which is the nasal mucosa, and then it proliferates. But unfortunately, this mucosal immunity remains impaired for a very prolonged time following recovery from infection. That is the reason why we are now seeing patients who have recovered from COVID, even after 6 to 8 weeks, they are developing mucormycosis. These are the series of cases that we have tabulated, which are published in the literature. Some are, of course, from India. Some are from the Western countries. Some are from Iran. When you put this all together, there are certain facts that stand out. One is that diabetes is a major contributing factor. Patients who have diabetes are known to have mucormycosis. That fact is getting very well established. Second is the use of corticosteroids. Corticosteroids in a prolonged period and for a higher dose is supposed to cause reduced immunity. Tocilizumab use in patients who are elderly, who are aged more than 65 or 70 years, the average age in the series of cases that have been published has been 68 years. So elderly individuals are more predisposed. And patients who have a severe COVID infection, who are on mechanical ventilation, who are on prolonged supplemental oxygen, can develop mucormycosis. It can occur concurrently or during the early or intermediate recovery phase. So concurrent is when the patient has a COVID infection, at that time mucormycosis can be seen, especially in the second week of infection, or during early recovery phase when the patient turns PCR negative, within a couple of weeks thereafter the patient can develop mucormycosis, or after 6 weeks. And the latest case that we have seen is after 3 months. So the earliest case that we have seen is when the patient had PCR positivity, on the third day he developed mucormycosis. And the most delayed manifestation is after 3 months. What is being seen currently is slightly worrisome. We thought that elderly individuals who had all these risk factors would develop mucormycosis. Now in the current wave, especially in the last few weeks, we are finding that young individuals who are in their 30s, very young individuals who are home cared absolutely with no or minimal steroids. Some patients have absolutely no steroids. They are not even diabetics. So patients in the 30s who are home cared without steroids, without oxygen, and non-diabetics are developing mucormycosis. So obviously there are multiple factors that are causative in this particular combination, and we are not able to, at this point in time, point out to one particular factor. There are obviously many factors if this has to occur in young individuals. That is something that is worrying. So why do we need staging in mucormycosis? Any disease has to have a triage kind of a system so that we stratify the risk and expedite care. Triaging is important so that the care is delivered systematically and in a very standardized format. It will also help us build protocols and improve outcomes. And more importantly, we may have a third wave and a fourth wave. So unless we build science into it and have very definitive protocols, then we will still be confused when we have many such cases in the years to come. So what is the basis for the staging that we are proposing? Staging is based on the sequence of anatomical progression of the disease. We all know that it starts in the nasal mucosa and the nasopharynx and paranasal sinuses, and then it progresses to the orbit and then to the central nervous system. So it follows the anatomical progression of the disease. And we also realize that there is severity in each anatomical location that has been taken into consideration. Based on that, there might be a change in management approach, which we'll know over time once the staging is validated and management is plugged in, and it may finally affect the overall prognosis. Now, how does anatomical progression take place? The point of entry and point of proliferation are nasal mucosa, middle, and the inferior turbinate. So the first structure in the nose to get affected is the nasal mucosa, and the first area of visible affection is in the area of middle turbinate, followed by inferior turbinate. When you look at a patient who has very early symptoms such as taste stuffiness of the nose, using diagnostic nasal endoscopy, you'll only find inflamed mucosa at the middle turbinate, which over a period of time, over a few hours, can get ulcerated, discolored, and then finally an eschar forms. Eschar is not the earliest manifestation. You may find a blackish discharge, granular discharge, a pale colored ulcer, a absolutely whitish ulcer, large mucosal ulceration, followed finally by eschar in the middle and inferior turbinate. Then it gets into the paranasal sinus. Ethmoid sinus is the earliest to get affected in 70% of patients as per the literature that we have, followed by maxillary and finally the sphenoid sinus. Orbit gets affected by multiple ways. One definite way is retrograde infection through the nasolacrimal duct. It gets into the nasolacrimal duct and the lacrimal sac, and the inframedial orbit is the first thing to get involved, or it breaches the lamina papyracea of ethmoid and gets to the medial orbit, or transsphenoidal to the orbital apex. There's also a third non-contiguous mechanism, that is by a vascular embolus. To the brain, it goes in either through the orbit, through the superior orbital fissure, inferior orbital fissure, or optic canal, or it can go through the cribriform plate. It has one more mechanism, that is transsphenoidal approach, and the most curious mechanism, which is slightly worrisome, is through the pterygopalatine fossa, through the foramen rotundum, directly into the midbrain. This causes bilateral third nerve palsy. So if a patient comes with bilateral third nerve palsy, then you should suspect this particular way of transmitting. There could also be a vascular embolus, which of course is a non-contiguous mechanism. Sometimes it bypasses all these channels and spreads erratically by vascular channels. So that is the last mechanism. With all this in place, we have proposed this classification, where stage one is involvement of the nasal mucosa and the disease is limited to the middle turbinate. Involvement of the inferior turbinate and the ostium of the nasolacrimal duct puts it into stage 1B. 1C is involvement of the nasal septum and 1D is bilateral. For each, there are specific symptoms, such as in this particular stage, the patient will have nasal stuffiness, nasal discharge, foul smell that he feels, and epistaxis. And when you look at these patients with diagnostic endoscopy, which is the first modality of diagnosis, then you may find that there is foul smelling sticky mucoid discharge, which may be initially mucoid, then it becomes black tinged or granular or hemorrhagic. Nasal mucosal inflammation may be found. This is just inflamed middle turbinate. Patient may have blackish discoloration. Then it turns violaceous, erythematous, violaceous, blue, and finally a pale ulcer and an eschar. There could also be nasal mucosal anesthesia, anesthesia of the tip of the nose or the alar area. And patient at that time may also have MRI findings. In fact, the first radiological sign of mucormycosis is a black middle turbinate. Look at this scan. This is contrast enhanced. You can see nasal mucosal enhancement, enhancement of the contralateral middle turbinate. But on the affected side, the middle turbinate is absolutely not enhancing. That is called the black turbinate sign. When you look at the MRI scan of the nasal mucosa, you can see here that this particular side is absolutely not enhancing. So non-enhancement of the nasal mucosa itself is one of the signs that indicates that there is an ischemic change already. And of course, there is involvement of the maxillary sinus as well. So these are the earliest radiological signs. In the orbital stage, the next stage is paranasal sinus, stage 2. Stage 2A is one sinus involvement, 2B is two ipsilateral sinuses are involved, 2C is when two ipsilateral sinuses and or palate or oral cavity are involved, and 2D is bilateral paranasal sinus involvement, with involvement of the bone or mandible or the palate. Now, in this situation, the patients continue to have symptoms, but the symptoms worsen with facial pain, facial edema, dental pain. In fact, patients may have loss of tooth, which was otherwise healthy. Systemic symptoms can also start at this stage. Signs continue to be the same as in stage one, maybe worse, but with unilateral or bilateral localized or diffuse facial edema, edema localized over the sinuses and localized sinus tenderness. And when you do this, investigate these patients with diagnostic nasal endoscopy, you'll find the same signs that are described with much more severity and ferocity. And contrast enhanced MRI is the preferred modality even at this stage. If that cannot be done, then you can use a CT scan, but either of which preferably contrast enhanced. And if contrast cannot be given because of poor renal function or allergy, etc., then only you can do a non-contrast CT scan. Confirmation of the diagnosis I'll come to a little later. These are some of the examples of stage 2 disease. This patient has predominantly ethmoid sinus involvement, single sinus involvement, stage 2A. This patient has an ethmoid sinus involvement and early maxillary sinus involvement. And as you see here, the infraorbital nerve area is involved. This is the reason why these patients have very early onset paresthesia or anesthesia over the area supplied by the infraorbital nerve, over the cheek area, basically numbness of the cheek. The patient may have a similar paresthesia or anesthesia in the area of the supraorbital nerve if this medial infectious process proceeds superiorly. So anesthesia and paresthesia are considered one of the early signs as well. And even this patient continues to have an inflamed turbinate, which is absolutely black, non-contrast enhancing, as compared to the contralateral turbinate. So black turbinate sign is one of the standard signs now radiologically. Patient may have an oral cavity lesion at that time that puts them in 2C, and bilateral paranasal sinus involvement makes them 2D. What we are concerned with are the orbital signs. In orbit, which is stage 3, we have 4 substages. Stage 3A is nasolacrimal duct, medial orbit. Both are involved or one is involved, where vision is unaffected. When there is diffuse involvement, which is defined as more than one quadrant or more than 2 structures in the orbit, still the vision is unaffected, then that is 3B. 3C is when there is central retinal artery or ophthalmic artery occlusion, superior ophthalmic vein thrombosis, involvement of the superior or inferior orbital fissure, orbital apex, and loss of vision. So this is the worst stage in the orbit. And of course, bilateral orbital involvement is something that we really don't want to see. So stage 3 is a very bad stage. So the watershed zone here is stage 3B. Until 3D, we can actually manage these patients with aggressive paranasal sinus surgery. And for the little orbital component, we can give intraorbital amphotericin B, which of course Shubha is going to talk about. But once the patient reaches stage 3C, then orbital excentration may become imminent very soon. Symptoms here are as in stage 1 and 2, but the patient begins to have pain in the eye, proptosis, ptosis, diplopia, loss of vision. Loss of vision could be because of two mechanisms. One is central retinal artery occlusion, which is sudden loss of vision. The second mechanism is compressive optic neuropathy, and that is a gradual loss of vision. Patients may have infraorbital and facial anesthesia, and these patients have exactly signs which are proportionate to symptoms. Patients begin to have conjunctival chemosis, isolated ocular motility restriction, they'll have ptosis, proptosis, and the anesthesia that I already described. Here again, the diagnostic tools remain the same: diagnostic nasal endoscopy and contrast enhanced MRI or CT scan. Rest of the investigation confirmation I'll come to a little later. These are some of the eyelid and periocular signs. This eyelid edema and periocular edema is not directly because of fungal invasion in that area. It is mainly because of necrosis, which produces inflammation. Even a little bit of necrosis of the orbital tissue can produce disproportionate edema around the orbit, around the periocular area, because of inflammation that is associated with necrosis. Patients coming at this stage with complete ocular motility, not restriction of ocular motility, And just a mechanical ptosis should not be suspected to have orbital apical involvement. In fact, this patient did not have orbital apical involvement. This was in the medial orbit that he had. And you can see that there is unilateral telecanthus. Distance between the midline and the medial canthus is increased on the right side. That was because of his gross ethmoidal sinus involvement with breach in the medial orbital wall, and the fungus has reached the inframedial orbital wall. Now, this is a patient where there is change in periocular color. Periocular discoloration also follows phases. The first phase is edema and erythema. Second phase is pallor. And then the patient may have bluish discoloration, and following bluish discoloration, it might settle down into permanent blackish discoloration, that is because of necrosis. This is an example of stage 3A disease where the patient has localized orbital involvement, and the first MRI sign in localized orbital involvement is thickening of the medial rectus. That is because of the medial process or the medial excess that the disease follows. Even if it comes from the nasolacrimal duct retrobulatory into the medial orbit, or if it breaches the lamina papyrusae of ethmoid and goes into the medial orbit, medial rectus area is the first to get involved in the orbit. And that is the reason why these patients have thickening of the medial rectus on CT scan or MRI. This is a patient who has diffuse disease. He has the ethmoidal component, thickening of the medial rectus. The disease has reached the medial orbit. He also has a little bit of orbital apical component. And all he has at this stage is very minimal proptosis and restriction of ocular mobility and mild ptosis. That is all he has. It's not a very dramatic manifestation at this point in time. This is very easily manageable with aggressive ENT surgery and intraorbital amphotericin injection. When this patient has even this stage where there is mild proptosis, medial and superior orbital involvement, this patient has supraorbital nerve anesthesia and ocular motility restriction in down gaze because of restrictive superior rectus, not because of inferior rectus involvement. This patient again can be managed quite conservatively without need for orbital excentration. Now, this is a very rapid evolution of proptosis and chemosis. This patient came with sudden onset ptosis. He went for a quick scan. Within a couple of hours when he came back, his disease had progressed. So that is how rapidly mucormycosis associated with COVID-19 is progressing these days. Earlier, when you used to see the same disease in diabetics, the progress was not so rapid. This seems to progress in a couple of hours. This is one more patient where there is stage 3C disease, where the superior orbital fissure and the orbital apex are involved. This patient came with sudden onset of ptosis. And as you see here, there is complete ophthalmoplegia with restriction of ocular motility in all directions of gaze. But compared to the earlier patient where I showed where inflammation predominates and there is obvious chemosis and red eye, this patient has an absolute white eye. That is because the first point of affection in this patient is the orbital apex, and that's a direct posterior orbital spread or a transsphenoidal spread into the orbital apex. She does not have a medial orbital involvement. She does not have anything else except orbital apical involvement. So this is a variant of manifestation of COVID-19 where the patient may come with, see, a white eye with ophthalmoplegia with very minimal periocular inflammation. She has very minimal fogginess of the periocular area and nothing as dramatic as the previous cases. So these patients, although they are much severe in 3C, may get ignored because they have very minimal signs, so to say. So unless they develop sudden onset of ptosis, their white eye may be simply brushed off as absolutely normal. This is one more example of a patient where there is minimal involvement of the paranasal sinus. All this patient has is thickness or thickening of the and enhancement of the maxillary sinus mucosa, but at the same time, patient has central retinal artery occlusion. This could also, loss of vision can also be because of compressive optic neuropathy that should be distinguished from CRAO. CRAO is very evident on ophthalmoscopy, and this CRAO is not reversible. This is not the embolus, cholesterol embolus that causes the typical CRAO. This is because of the fungal affection of the blood vessel lumen, which causes a permanent block for a very long segment of the central retinal artery. This is not a small embolus. So these patients cannot be managed with anterior chamber paracentesis, Diamox, ocular compression, etc. Now, why all this happens is easily understandable by the proximity of the structures in the orbital apex, optic nerve and the ophthalmic artery, superior orbital fissure and inferior orbital fissure. From wherever the fungus enters, all these areas being in very close proximity, damage can occur very fast. This is an example of a diffuse orbital involvement phase, stage 3C. This patient obviously needs orbital excentration. This is an unfortunate bilateral involvement. Still, you can see that the patient does not have significant amount of proptosis in the left eye. Predominant disease is in the ethmoid, yet you can see this acquired telecanthus that this patient has developed with bilateral involvement of the orbit. This is a very unfortunate situation which we really don't want to see. Stage 4 is CNS involvement. CNS involvement initially would mean focal or partial cavernous sinus involvement or involvement of the cribriform plate. Stage 4B is diffuse cavernous sinus involvement and of or cavernous sinus thrombosis. 4C is involvement beyond the cavernous sinus to skull base, internal carotid artery occlusion, brain infarction, etc. And 4D is multifocal or diffuse CNS disease. Again, up to 4B, these patients are manageable with reasonable amount of prognosis. Once it goes to 4C and D, that has a very poor prognosis. This is an example of a patient where cavernous sinus is involved diffusely, stage 4B disease. Following surgery, this patient obviously was not excentrated. You can see an intact eye here. Following sinus debridement and amphotericin B, the cavernous sinus component has reasonably well cleared and this patient has recovered quite well. This is a patient who came with sudden onset of ptosis but very, very minimal proptosis but with ocular motility restriction. When you look at this patient critically, his affection is through the not through the conventional route but actually through the pterygopalatine fossa, foramen rotundum and directly to the midbrain. These patients can tend to have bilateral third nerve palsy. This is the route that it follows. Now, this is a patient with 4C where there is brain infarction, and this is a patient, unfortunately, with 4D disease with diffuse CNS. Now, coming to the diagnosis, when you see a patient with suspected mucormycosis, when the patient has all the symptoms of mucormycosis and you suspect based on clinical evaluation, first thing that you do is not imaging, but a nasal cavity examination by a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. If you see an abnormal area of inflammation, ulcer or an eschar, then you take a swab from that particular area. You really cannot take swab blindly. If you don't have access to endoscopy, then only you rely on a blind swab. But a blind swab only has about 25% rate of positivity. Whereas if you take an endoscopy guided swab, then positivity can be stepped up to 50 or even 75%. Second thing that we have proposed is that you do a microbiopsy. Right in the OPD room, you can do a small microbiopsy, take a bit of nasal mucosa which looks affected, not from the real necrotic area, and send it for two things. One is a microbiology evaluation with KOH and calculflu white. Culture, of course, will take time. And second is histopathology. This is not fixed histopathology, but squash and imprint or frozen section, which can give you diagnosis in 15 minutes. Also, microbiology, KOH mount and calculflu white can give you diagnosis in 15 minutes. So it's a very rapid way of diagnosing. And the same microbiopsy specimen can be sent for fixed sections. And all these have to be stained with special stains. Patch and GMS are recommended. Serology and PCR based diagnostics are currently not so much in vogue. The areas that you take biopsy and the swab from are very critical. If you take it from an area which is actually involved and not blindly, then your diagnostic accuracy actually improves. CT scan is okay for diagnosis. You can diagnose the disease by looking at a CT scan, but unless it is contrast enhanced, then you won't get much information. What is recommended is MRI, because MRI scans actually precede CT scans, and you can also know the extent of the disease. It helps you in staging and also shows the perfusion status. Going on to management. Now, this is an article that was written in the pre-COVID era, but it has one of the largest number of cases, 900 odd cases. where it was shown clearly that if a patient does not receive treatment, then only 3% of them survive, which is extremely bad. But if they're treated only with medical treatment or surgery, then about 60% is the life salvage. When they have both, 70% can have life salvage. This is what is known. So management triage is very critical. So this is how we triage the patient. If a patient based on symptoms has probable rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, then we do a RT-PCR. If the patient is RT-PCR positive, then the patient is admitted with all COVID precautions in the COVID ward. If the patient is RT-PCR negative, then you can admit under critical care, ENT or ophthalmology as the condition mandates. Timing is the key to management. In routine mucormycosis, we know that when a few days delay can double mortality. In COVID-related mucormycosis, it has come to few hours. In fact, the disease is so rapidly progressive that delay is not warranted at all. This is the system that we follow for management. Based on the typical symptoms and signs in a clinical setting of concurrent or recently treated COVID, that means the setting has to be appropriate, you diagnose it as possible rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. But if the symptoms are suggestive of mucormycosis, but there are no clinical signs at all, there is no supportive evidence at all when the patient manifests, it could be a false alarm. These patients, of course, are not let loose, but you closely observe them on supportive treatment and repeat diagnostic nasal endoscopy after 24 hours. And if the patient is improving, then mucormycosis is unlikely. Still, you observe them for 3 weeks. If a patient has symptoms and signs, that is probable mucormycosis, these patients are initiated on intravenous amphotericin B as soon as possible. If a patient under observation starts worsening and develops new onset supportive evidence, again, this patient is initiated on amphotericin. So basically, you initiate on amphotericin based on clinico-radiological criteria and not really wait for microbiology or histopathology, which may delay the diagnosis and thus delay the treatment. When the patient has everything else, that means clinico-radiologically, there is correlation, and on microscopy and histopathology, there is confirmation, then that patient has proven ROCM, and again, that patient has to be started on amphotericin. But we would like to ideally catch them at the stage of probable ROCM, then wait for microbiology and pathology only to confirm the diagnosis, but still start the patient on medical management, which is aggressive intravenous amphotericin B, preferably liposomal. 5 mg per kg body weight is preferred. Underdosing and escalation of dosing are not advised. And if that is not available, then you can use deoxyate or lipid complex. Little less expensive, but less effective as well, and more toxic to the kidney. If the patient has a bad renal function and you cannot start on amphotericin, then alternatives are isavuconazole or posaconazole in the doses that are shown. And when you start these patients on medical management, the next prioritization is for surgery. If the patient is fit for surgery, you go for surgery immediately. Suppose the patient is not yet fit for surgery and the patient has to be medically prepared for surgery, then as soon as possible, surgery has to be taken up. Now, surgery is prioritized as this. If the patient has stage 1 to 2 or stage 3 A to B, that means that there is predominant sinonasal manifestation with limited orbital involvement, vision is preserved, then you do an early aggressive debridement. It falls into the realm of an ENT surgeon. Early aggressive debridement of paranasal sinuses by an appropriate surgical approach with additional procedures as required. Then for the orbit, you give retrobulbar amphotericin B. 3.5 mg per ml is described for deoxycholate actually, but the same dose can be used with liposomal as well, but the volume is slightly more with liposomal because it comes in the preparation of 1 mg per ml. Whereas deoxycholate is prepared as 3.5 mg per ml. Either which way is fine. You can use any preparation of amphotericin, but you should do a targeted injection right in the area where the disease is, which you have evaluated already by radiology. For example, if the lesion is in the medial orbit, then the injection must be given in the medial orbit, in the area of the lesion around that. And for the sinus, you irrigate with amphotericin B 1 mg/mL, and endoscopy guided repeat debridement is ideal. Then when the patient stabilizes, you put them on a step down therapy with isavuconazole or posaconazole. If the patient, after having undergone a paranasal sinus surgery, continues to worsen, there is disease progression within 72 hours, you note that either the patient is not improving or there is progression in the orbital condition, then you can perform orbital excentration. Post-op protocol is the same. But if the patient, when he presents, has stage 3 C to D or has stages 4 A to B, that means limited CNS involvement, then you do orbital excentration along with paranasal sinus surgery. This can be combined if, as long as the orbital disease is unilateral, then continue with the same protocol. If the patient has stage 4 C and D, if the patient is fit for surgery, you can do all this. Unfortunately, most of these patients who are in 4 C and D may not be fit for surgery. If the patient has been unfit for surgery, then you only do what is possible in terms of medical management. The indications for ophthalmologists for orbital excentration is that if there is diffuse orbital involvement, unilateral disease, you don't want to generally do bilateral orbital excentration, although sometimes it becomes mandatory to save life, no or minimal extension to cavernous sinus, or worsening of orbital component or no improvement within 72 hours after paranasal sinus surgery and on full dose of amphotericin B. These have been our current standard indications for orbital excentration in patients with mucormycosis in association with COVID. This is an example of a patient who has undergone orbital excentration. Even in this case, we would like to spend additional 15 minutes and do a skin covered orbital cavity. So basically a lid sparing or a partially lid sparing excentration so that the patient can use an excentration prosthesis. This patient was managed with medical therapy for the orbit. She received intraorbital amphotericin B, and for the paranasal sinuses, of course, we have done an aggressive paranasal sinus debridement, and over a period of time you can see that the cavernous sinus lesion has completely settled. Can we prevent this condition at all? There are several preventive strategies that have been advised. Most of this is very logical, such as compliance to steroid protocol, compliance to tocilizumab, control of diabetes mellitus, etc., and also oxygen hygiene to maintain sterile water in the humidifier, daily change, etc., when the patient is on oxygen. Personal hygiene beyond discharge, the patient has to wear a barrier because mucor is an airborne disease, and obviously it can enter the area where the mucosal immunity is breached by means of contaminated atmosphere. So mucosal protection using a barrier mask is advisable. Oral posaconazole as prophylactic measure is being advocated by some groups in very selected group of individuals, and that is still debated. Corticosteroids are to be given only when indicated. Indian guidelines are slightly lax on steroid use, but when you look at the international guidelines, there are very specific dosage and duration schedules which possibly we also need to follow. Red flag signs have to be explained to the COVID care teams and also to the patients at the time of discharge, so that if they notice any of this, they should seek the help of their COVID care physicians or ophthalmologists or ENT surgeons as appropriate. The incidence is very low in terms of the volume. We have 8,000 cases, all right, but when you extrapolate that data into the number of COVID cases that have happened in India, we see that only one in about 1,000 patients in admitted category and two in 10,000 patients in all PCR positive patients. So that is a small number as compared to the volume of COVID patients that we have. So general screening is not possible. This will overwhelm the medical system if you start doing diagnostic endoscopy on every patient who is admitted or every patient who is PCR positive. Then it is not impossible to salvage the situation. So we have to have high index of suspicion and specific timely consultation that can actually help. So moderation of steroid use, moderation of tocilizumab, awareness of red flags, and a timely ENT ophthalmology consultation are really important to salvage the situation. prophylactic antifungals are still not proven, and further studies are required to understand why this is happening, because this is multifactorial. At least we can zero in on a couple of important risk factors beyond diabetes and steroid use and start controlling the situation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Santosh. Thanks a lot. I always learn many new things from you because of your in-depth knowledge. And thank you for joining us on a short notice. Santosh, we have some questions that we'll take after the all talks. Sure. So please stay with us. That Aarti, please invite next speaker.
Sir, one question. Just we take, meanwhile, Subramanian ready for next talk. Sir, should we wait till no PL for exenteration? That is the question from Dr. Milind.
No, we should not wait for no PL for exenteration. If the disease is progressive, the patient does not have useful vision, and if you think that your exenteration is required to salvage life, you can go ahead in an eye with good or even partial vision. Vision is not the criteria, but the extent of the disease is the criteria, and that you assess on MRIs.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Dr. Shobhai, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please start.
Kindly share.
So at the outset, I would like to thank this PG Forum for inviting me for this talk on transcutaneous retrobulbar amphotericin B, TRAM, the in orbital mucormycosis. So I'm glad to share this forum with Dr. Deepak Mishra, Dr. Satanshu Mathur, Dr. Grover sir, and Dr. Santosh Honawar. Thank you very much. So as Dr. Honawar has just now briefed us all with this rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis. This is a dreadful life-threatening disease seen in immunocompromised post-COVID patients. And as we all know that the path, it starts from the nose and then traverses to the orbit and then the... So, we should have a high index of suspicion in patients who have uncontrolled diabetes, diabetic ketoacidosis, those treated with steroids, immunomodulators, those on mechanical ventilators, or prolonged ICU stay more than 3 weeks, and long-standing oxygen therapy, and immunocompromised patients post-transplant, or having malignancy or on voriconazole therapy. Is my screen visible properly?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
You can see this.
Okay. So life-saving measures we need to go for, because this is a life-threatening disease, and so early diagnosis and a high clinical suspicion we should follow, and early and aggressive intervention. Why? Because this disease progresses in 4 to 5 days. We are seeing patients progressing to the stages where they just succumb. So early intervention is the key. That's why clinical signs should not be ignored. And of course, the physicians who are discharging COVID patients must guide their patients on follow-up to how to take care and come at the earliest signs. Then diagnostic tests, we must do our nasal swab. This is done by an ENT doctor with a specialized, the method to do the nasal swab, and then it is put on KOH mount, and we can get very early reports with this. So on microscopy, you can see the septi hyphae, and CT PNS to see go for sinusitis, and MRI to note the extent of disease involving the sinuses or the orbit or the cavernous sinus or the brain. So this is this should be carried out very fast. Like at the very first suspicion, you should go for all these tests. Like this is a team approach, of course, wherein all the ophthalmologists, the ENT surgeon, the neurosurgeon are involved, the endocrinologist and the physician go hand in hand for this team approach. So first and foremost, we should start with systemic antifungals. Then comes the glycemic control, which is again the most important thing in this, reversal of immune status, and then comes the role of surgical treatment. So functional endoscopic sinus surgery and debridement of multiple sinuses has to be done at the earliest, and debridement of any other devitalized tissue like medial periorbita if the orbit shows early involvement. And of course, irrigation with local antifungals after FES or this debridement. And lastly, the excentration. And we as ophthalmologists just don't want to go for this excentration surgery, but if it is life-saving, we have to do it. Now, where does this local amphotericin B stand? Now, why should you go for a local thing? Now, as Dr. Santosh Honnavar has discussed, vaso-occlusive disease, this is what the COVID mucormycosis is. And this leads to ischemia, necrosis of the tissue, which invites the fungus in an immunocompromised host. And diabetics and ketoacidosis, they suffer. Serum ferritin high levels also invite this fungus. And dead devitalized tissues there with compromised blood vasculature. And therefore, the systemic antifungals find it difficult to reach the local tissue. That is why I find this TRAM or transcutaneous retrobulbar amphotericin B injection as a viable and adjunct therapeutic option in select cases, of course. So what are the indications? First is an early orbital presentation. Very important, a very early orbital presentation. Some viable orbital tissue is still present. So you know that only some part is affected and rest of the tissue is still viable. So burden of this orbital tissue is not substantial. So you don't want to remove the whole or excentrate the whole tissue because some tissue is still viable. And where aggressive orbital debridement is not favorable or is not possible. And cases of advanced disease as waiting for fitness for excentration, there you may try this. But this cannot replace excentration as excentration is a life-saving procedure. Now, amphotericin B is available as a deoxycholate and a liposomal variety. And as Sir has just mentioned, that deoxycholate has a dose-limiting factor because it is renal toxic. And what more you need to observe are potassium levels, because hypokalemia may be there leading to arrhythmias. Then you have to take care of magnesium levels, find out ECG, so take care of this. And also anaphylactic reactions are known where you give IV antifungals. So for that, you must, intradermally test this. And reconstitution. Now, reconstitution of retrobulbar amphotericin B is important. Now, dilute this 50 milligram vial with 10 ml of sterile water for injection to make it 5 milligram per ml. And again, dilute it with 1 ml to make it around 3.5 milligrams per ml. So, this is the dose that we employ. And the dose being 1 ml of this retrobulbar injection, 3.5 milligrams. Do not dilute or mix with any other medicine, including xylocaine. So you are not supposed to dilute it with anything else but sterile water injection. You have to protect it from light. So whenever you're keeping it, better to cover it. And you have to keep it, store it in the fridge at 4 degrees. And now how much is that to be given? So you can administer it alternate day. That is what we are using. So alternate day, maybe 3 injections. Now, precautions that you must take care are: ask about any severe drug allergy or anaphylactic shock or any respiratory problem. Ask the patient prior and always keep a crash card ready with you. Take an informed consent. And these are the things that are required. So xylocaine, 0.5 ml xylocaine needs to be injected earlier, before, and then after 5 minutes, you inject this reconstituted retrobulbar amphotericin B. And there are chances of a transient or vital inflammation secondary to this, but in very few cases, because I feel 0.5 ml of xylocaine and 1 ml of amphotericin B won't give rise to so much of or vital compartment syndrome. Now, how to administer? So, this was a patient wherein FS was done, and then because of his limited or vital involvement, we went in for a retrobulbar injection post-FES. So, how frequently you must give is, we are giving it alternate day for maybe 3 injections. And of course, judge the progress and later on decide whether to go for, if it is progressing, to go for an MRI after 72 hours and then decide for whether needs to be taken for excentration or not. Now, this is a small or a very clinical, approach that we have advised my residents. Have made this slide, and this is about a schematic picture is showing. Now here you can see here at Aurangabad, we are getting lot many cases of this because the COVID has come down, and now we are getting lot many mucormycosis cases, and Aurangabad as such was on flame for COVID also. So that's why we are getting too many cases. Of course, they are coming from the periphery, rural peripheries and other places, but a lot of cases. And also awareness has increased, the physicians have advised, so cases are coming at early stages also. So if you see a patient with just an edema surrounding the lower lid, only an edema, and rest of the eye findings are normal, then the patient should go for an early FES. This is what I have talked to my residents. So early clinical findings, you may say, and edema, just a small chemosis and edema under the lower eyelid, and vision is not affected, rest of the things are normal, then again this FES will take care of this. So no need to intervene ophthalmologically, but an early FES will treat this patient. Now, if there is a periorbital edema, a lot more of edema, and then proptosis, ptosis is there, chemosis is there, extraocular movements are restricted, but the vision is not affected, here the role of TRAM comes. And cases where there's a frank periorbital edema, a lot of chemosis, eschar is there, which denotes ischemia. So here, and also the extraocular muscle movements are restricted, and vision is PL, that is PL negative, okay, no PL. So there you have to go for an excentration. So this is just an overview, a clinical overview. Of course, this needs to be followed with correlation with a CT, PNS or an MRI to exactly like guide what treatment you're going to do. Now, this was a case which has come with a facial pain, just a facial pain here and a periorbital edema. But for her, just a FES has sufficed and the edema has come down, and an early FES is the treatment for this. This is again another one, periorbital edema with a very slight chemosis over here, you can see. And this also, we went for FES, no TRAM over here. Now, this case with an inferior localized chemosis, but extraocular movements restricted, but vision loss is there. So here again, you have to go for excentration, not TRAM. Now, this case, this person came with early facial pain and complaints of headache. He was admitted in a COVID ward, and there he started complaining of a headache, and then we got him very early. And we did his MRI, and then he started developing some restriction of lateral movement. So again, here we gave in TRAM. injection. Now, this Babaji had a good vision with full and free extraocular muscles. And CT showed a frontoethmoid maxillary involvement with extraconal involvement. You can see a medial rectus prominence here. And fat standing was also seen. And this, you can see here, just a very light fullness is there and no very obvious signs. So here again, we have given TRAM to this case. Now, this one had a good vision, a very small periorbital edema and extraocular movements were full and final. So here, we went in for an early FES. This patient had a good vision, but again, on CT showed medial involvement of the orbit. So for him also, we have given TRAM. This case again had a periorbital lot of edema and chemosis, and extraocular movements were restricted. On MRI, he had pansinusitis and a very minimal involvement of the orbit. So this is a post-TRAM pic, which shows that his edema has reduced and it has given a good result. So the same patient. So here you can see the muscles showing nicely, and there is no loss of contrast enhancement over here. So that's where we use TRAM. This is another case who had a limited chemosis over here, and this went ahead with a FES and retrobulbar injection with that, showing his vision also improved and his extraocular muscle movements also improved. So this was that case where MR was prominent and fat standing was noted, and we went in for TRAM over here. This was a COVID positive case in the ward where he had no PL and it was restricted in all cases. He had some PL. So again, for him, we went in for TRAM, and because he is still positive and he is not fit for surgery, so that's why we went in for TRAM here. And then his proptosis reduced and his vision has improved, and his movements also have improved. This obvious case of no PL vision with an orbital apex syndrome and an extraconal and an intraconal involvement, loss of contrast enhancement, had to go for excentration. This again with an eschar, a proptosis, an orbital apex syndrome, and a no PL had to go for excentration. Now this was, as Dr. Honover was discussing, this was a very quiet eye, okay, a quiet eye, a collapsed eyeball, vision was no PL, and the optic nerve thickened with loss of contrast enhancement, and this had to go for excentration. But I would like to say a word of caution for this. Very judicious use of TRAM, and correlating the clinical picture, the KOH study or the biopsy positivity, and the CT or MRI findings. Because right now I am seeing some of my private practitioner friends who have, once you see a patient of orbital edema coming to you, they start giving TRAM. But that need not be done, and a judicious use of this procedure is important. Otherwise, the disease might progress and we might lose the case. So in conclusion, I should say episode of transient orbital inflammation was noted in just one patient out of the 10 that we have given. But progression of orbital infection was halted and visual acuity was restored. So I find this an advantageous and a simple bedside procedure which is giving promising results in our hands, and this locally minimizes the fungal load. So TRAM in conjunction with IV antifungals and FES can salvage the globe and vision of the patient. That's important. So these are my references. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shiva, for elaborate about this treatment part and indication of this disease. And as we are running, we will take question another Arti later on. So you can invite next speaker.
Yes, sir. So I now invite Dr. Ravi to give us a talk on neurological aspect of mucormycosis.
Dr. Ravi is HOD in the Chijet BHU Institute. Dr. Ravi, please welcome.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, very well.
Yes. Dr. Ravi, kindly share your screen.
Yeah, I am trying.
So till the time Dr. Ravi is setting his screen, I have a question from our audience.
Person.
Yeah, I have a question for ma'am regarding the amphotericin injection. Does retrovulvar ampho have significant systemic absorption?
Because it acts locally, systemic absorption, I don't find itna hoga. So, but still you have to be careful, check for KFTs and renal function tests, and then only give, only in safe cases, yeah.
What's your opinion on this?
Well, the dose is very small. You're giving just 3.5 milligram and your dose is 5 milligram per kilogram. So in any case, that will not be a problem. But as far as if the hypersensitivity exists, then of course there can be an issue. And you are testing that before you're giving a retrovulvar injection. So, and not in terms of nephrotoxicity or anything, this small dose will not matter.
So, Dr. Ravi, are we able to start your presentation now?
Are my slides visible?
Not yet.
No, slides are not visible.
But we can hear you clearly.
You can stop and then again start screen sharing, sir.
Meanwhile, we can take another question.
Dr. Satyam, we have another question regarding the ampho injection. Do we need to give 3 injections from same stored vial, and the dose is just 1 injection per day?
Yes, the dose is just 1 injection per day, and a few people, they give it continuous for 3 days, but I would like to give it alternate day, and 3 injections, yes, from the same vial, you can store it and use it for 3 injections.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Ravi, Dr. Ravi, please.
Your slides are visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah, can you put it on slideshow?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Is it okay now?
We are good to go, sir. We are good to go.
Okay. At the outset, I would like to congratulate and thank to Dr. Deepak, who has invited me to deliver a talk in this webinar. So my talk today would be very simple. For most of the things have been very well covered by Dr. Santosh Hanover, and also Dr. Shubhra ma'am has also covered most of the things I would like to cover. But I would cover the topic, that is neurosurgical aspect of the mucormycosis in this COVID-19 era. I will be talking very briefly. To start with introduction, mucormycosis, as we all know, refers to the invasive disease caused by filamentous fungi belonging mucorales order. The patients mostly at risk are poorly controlled diabetes, diabetic patients, immunocompromised patients like in AIDS, and patients on immunosuppressants like for various hematological malignancies and transplant patients. Mucormycosis can also enter by trauma, also soft tissue disease. So the clinical presentation of mucormycosis is shaped by the immune characteristics of the host. Depending upon the predisposing conditions, we have mainly 3 types of patients: patients of diabetes mellitus, patients who are on immunosuppressants for various transplants and hematological neoplasm, and the trauma patients. Now, rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis is more common in diabetic patients, while the immunosuppressed patients, they mostly present with cyanopulmonary. And trauma patients, they mainly present with mucormycosis of the skin and the soft tissue. The hallmark, as already discussed, is the angioinvasion, which causes tissue invasion and infarctions, which is secondary. Involvement of central nervous system is the severe form of. This table shows the CNS involvement with respect to underlying condition, and it is very well seen that the CNS involvement is most common in diabetic patients and patients who have received contaminated injection. Regarding microbiology, Rhizopus, mucor, and Artemia are the most common fungi which comprise 70 to 80% of the cases. And CNS mucormycosis, in CNS mucormycosis, Rhizopus is the most shared. Other uncommon species are also here. Pathogenesis has already been discussed in great detail by Dr. Bush, but I would like to highlight that the primary route of entry is of the fungus are by the paranasal sinuses. Normally, neutrophils and macrophages block the replication, but in neutropenics and patients on steroids, immunosuppressed patients, and diabetic patients, this mechanism is disturbed, and the fungal proliferation and angiosis, and which further leads to necrosis, and of course enhanced with the iron overload, this all causes fungal proliferation. And finally, reaches to the brain as ROCM, and extensive necrosis and angioinvasion, which also limits the drug delivery and immune response, and finally dissemination occurs. This is the briefly about the pathogenesis. Now we can very well see that the sinuses are in close proximity to the brain. There is thin skull base, so CNS, so direct penetration from the paranasal sinuses and orbits is the most, is very common. However, the hematogenous spread is also common. So there is two modes of penetration to CSF, CNS, that is hematogenous and the direct spread. Now, CNS mucormycosis can present in various ways. Patients with mucormycosis of the ethmoid sinus are at high risk of cavernous sinus thrombosis because the valveless emissary veins, which drain to these transverse sinuses and lamina papyracea and facilitate fungal invasion of the periorbital tissue. Maxillary sinus infection often spreads to the heart palate and ethmoid sinus, and ethmoid sinus can go to the cavernous sinus. Infection of the sphenoid sinus can extend to the cavernous sinus or can invade the carotid artery directly, and from there embolization can lead to frontal and parietal lobe involvement. Uncommon manifestations of cranial invasion include superior sagittal sinus thrombosis, and epidural or subdural abscesses can also be there. Meningitis is also a rare event, but when present, it may manifest as obstructive hydrocephalus to infiltration of ventricular lining. By any route, the mucorales enter the brain by way of cerebral vascular system, and from there the fungal hyphae grow along the internal elastic lamina. Arterial lumen obliterates with thrombus, and intimal hyperplasia occurs. This leads to cerebral infarction and necrosis, and this occurs without hyphal invasion of the brain tissue. Now, once the necrotic hypoxemic environment impairs both innate immune cells and antifungal drugs from accessing on mucorales, the hyphal invasion of the necrotic brain parenchyma occurs, and this is really a terminal event. These patients are really have poor prognosis. The presence of giant cells and granuloma formation has got good prognosis, and this is present in relatively preserved immune response. Now, reasons for increase of mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients has already been highlighted. hyperglycemia due to uncontrolled pre-existing diabetes, rampant use of steroids, new onset diabetes due for use of steroids, prolonged ICU stay and irrational use of broad spectrum antibiotics, and of course the pre-existing comorbidities which already have been said, that hematological malignancies, use of immunosuppressants and solid organ transplants, they all these are all the reasons for rapid rise in mucormycosis event. Breakthrough infection in patients on varicocele is also now a clinical presentation is varied. The patient can present with loss of smell, facial pain, pain over the sinuses, pain in teeth and gums. Paresthesia can be there on one half or even on both sides of the face. Blackish discoloration of skin over nasolabial groove, nasal crusting and nasal discharge which could be blackish or bloody. Conjunctival injection or phimosis can be there. Periorbital swelling, proptosis, ophthalmoplegia. These are present once involvement of orbit is there. Blurring of vision, diplopia, loosening of teeth, discoloration of palate, gangrenous inferior terminates, and finally this CNS manifestations can be there. Now in CNS involvement of mucormycosis, the cavernous sinus is the first intracranial structure to be involved most of the times. Cavernous sinus thrombosis may impair the function of the ocular motor nerves 3, 4 and 6 and V1 and V2 branches of the 5th nerve. These are all travels to the cavernous sinus. Hemiparesis, altered consciousness and focal seizures are indicators of brain invasion and infarction, and they are poor prognostic indicators. The three most frequent imaging findings in intracranial mucormycosis are cavernous sinus from brain infarction and internal carotid artery. So this photo to understand the invasion of cavernous sinus and its manifestation. The proximity of cavernous sinus to the orbit and its various venous channels are very well seen. Also the involvement of various cranial nerves and the carotid artery can be appreciated in the second picture. These are the clinical photographs of the patient with varying manifestations, including the hyperemia and inflammation of the skin and subcutaneous tissue over the maxillary sinus in the first picture. There is skin necrosis in the second picture, and there is involvement of there is proptosis and third nerve involvement and phimosis in the third picture. Stages of RCM, RCM is mainly classified in three stages. Stage 1 is the infection of the nasal mucus and the sinuses. Stage 2 is orbital involvement, and stage 3 is cerebral involvement. Complications include brain infarction, which occurs due to vascular invasion or diffuse vasculitis. Vasculitis can cause aneurysm formation and can rupture to lead to subarachnoid hemorrhage, subdural or intracerebral bleeds. Orbital apex syndrome, meningitis, brain abscess, facial and nasal deformity and Garcin syndrome are other complications of rhinocerebral.
Hello.
How do you approach rhino or
right.
Can you
find the diagnosis?
Yeah, should be fine.
Shall I carry on?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Ravi, please continue.
Okay. Timely diagnosis and early intervention is the rule. And all suspected ROCM patients, urgent CT and preferably MRI with contrast of the paranasal sinuses, orbit and brain should be done. Endoscopic examination of nasal passage and biopsy should be done early based upon the suspicion, and tissue should be sent for routine microscopy, histopathological examination and cultures. for pulmonary diseases, bronchoalveolar lavage, biopsy, or both should be done. For cutaneous diseases, skin biopsy for pathology and culture should be obtained. Laboratory investigations, all patients should undergo complete blood count, blood glucose, bicarbonate and electrolytes. Arterial blood gas analysis should be done. Iron levels of ferritin and TIBC should be evaluated. And if suspecting him to be a case of fungal meningitis, then CSF should be tapped for routine and micro examination. Blood cultures should also be done. However, these blood cultures are usually negative. And MRI with contrast or CT scan with contrast are the investigations of choice. However, X-ray PNS and face can be done, which shows sinus involvement with mucosal thickening. There can be air fluid levels and bony erosions and destruction can also be seen. MRI of the facial sinuses and brain is superior to CT scan in assessing the degree of tissue invasion and need for ongoing surgery. Non-enhancing mucosal tissue within the involved sinuses and terminates on contrast MRI, that is black turbinate sign, is the hallmark, and it is not present in the bacterial sinusitis where the mucosa take contrast very well. This is the first picture is a coronal CT scan of a patient, which shows soft tissue density involving both ethmoid sinuses and left maxillary sinus, and also there is involvement of the orbit. This is the axial CT scan, which again shows the involvement of soft tissue density lesion in the orbit. This is an MRI axial T1 of a patient where hypointense mucosal thickening of left ethmoid cells are seen, and soft tissue swelling is seen in the preorbital region. This is the preorbital soft tissue swelling is seen, and hypointense lesion, a soft tissue lesion is seen lateral, extending in the cone and is extending in the cavernous sinus, which is pushing the carotid on this side, on the opposite side, and is also partially compressed. The similar finding in contrast is seen in this MRI T1 contrast. This is the T2 MRI of the same patient. Shows hyperintense left ethmoidal cells. The soft tissue swelling is seen anterior to left eyeball, and left orbital hyperintense signal intensity lesion is seen extending along orbital apex into the cavernous sinus. Here we can very well see. And this is the diffusion weighted imaging, same patient, which shows hyperintense signal in the preorbital region. This is a large MCA infarct in another patient, probably secondary to venous arterial thrombosis of the middle cerebral artery, or maybe due to tunnel carotid artery. Now biopsy is the diagnostic procedure for confirmation, and is obtained from nasal, palatine, lung, tenous, gastrointestinal or abscess wall site. The stains, which already has been discussed, are 10% KOH, hematoxylin and eosin, or fungal specialized fungal stains like GMS or PAS stains are also. The pathognomic feature of this microscopy in the microscope, we see is broad, irregular, ribbon-like, non-septate hyphae with irregular branching, and the branching occurs at perpendicular to the main branch, that is 90 degrees. Neutrophil infiltration, vessel invasion, and tissue infarction are also seen, and granulomatous reaction may also be seen in patients with good immune response. Treatment, regarding treatment, one should have high index of suspicion of invasive fungal infections because early intervention is the key for treatment, and timely initiation of the treatment reduces mortality. Multidisciplinary team approach is required. Treatment of mucormycosis involves combination of surgical debridement and antifungal therapy. But this table outlines the recommendation briefly, which involves surgical debridement, antifungal treatment, and other ancillary treatments. Medical treatment, the liposomal amphotericin B is the drug of choice. In CNS cases, if CNS is involved, 10 mg per kg is the recommended dose, and it should be continued till a favorable response is achieved and disease is stabilized. After usually 3 to 4 weeks of amphotericin B, posaconazole or isavuconazole can be given in oral form. But the therapy has to be continued until clinical resolution of signs and symptoms of infection is there, as well as resolution of radiological signs of active disease and elimination of predisposing risk factors such as hyperglycemia, immunosuppression, etc. Now, in case liposomal amphotericin B is not available, conventional amphotericin B can be used, but this is very nephrotoxic and should be renal function should be monitored. The dose of conventional amphotericin B is 1 to 1.5 milligram. Surgical intervention in mucormycosis, surgical debridement is considered a mainstay of treatment. Extent of surgical debridement varies from limited to radical resection. Endoscopic surgery has been advocated for early localized invasive fungal sinusitis, and open surgery is reserved for patients with orbital and intracranial extension. Extensive surgery such as orbital eccentration and craniofacial resection is associated with significant morbidity and disfigurement. Now, regarding indications for neurosurgery, they are very limited. Pure neurosurgical interventions indications are there. Decompressive craniectomy is performed in patients with large hemispheric infarcts, especially if they are producing mass effect. And to avoid herniation, to save the life of patient, decompressive craniectomy is done. Now, in patients with meningitis, which I already said can produce obstructive hydrocephalus, CSF diversion procedures should be done. And excision of fungal lesions can be done if it is involving some lobe of pain. Debridement of affected skull. So these are the four indications for neurosurgery. This is the this picture, the various routes for endoscopic debridement through the sinuses. This shows various approaches for debriding different areas of brain. And this is the entry for cavernous sinus. The various corridors are there, various triangles are there. Now, since the cavernous sinus is the most common and earliest involved structure in orbitocerebral mucormycosis, various corridors for debriding or taking biopsy from this region, although this is very rarely indicated in CNS mucormycosis. Various triangles are there where we can take biopsy for site. Other ancillary treatment modalities are hyperbaric oxygen, iron chelation therapy, however not well established. Immunity can be heightened by administering granulocyte colony stimulating factors. which increases the production of leukocytes. Azoles can be used as salvage therapy. Rapid reversal of underlying cause and immunosuppression is the first thing to be done. And if possible, steroids and chemotherapeutic immunosuppression should be stopped, or should its dose should be minimized. Prognosis is poor in most cases despite very aggressive therapy. Prognosis can be enhanced comparatively by early diagnosis and prompt treatment. Mortality rate depends upon the severity and extension of the disease. Mortality in rhinocerebral form is around 30 to 70%. In disseminated form is around 90%, and in patients with AIDS it's 100%. It is demonstrated that the survival rate of combination of surgical debridement and antifungal therapy is 70%, and surgery alone is 57%, and chemotherapy alone is 61%. There are certain measures.
Sorry to interrupt, Dr. Ravi, if you can wind up. Thank you.
Okay, this is the last slide I want. So, okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi, for your wonderful talk. Our next speaker is Dr. Manish sir. We are thankful to him that he accepted our invitation in very short notice, and he directly came today for this webinar from the OT. And also, I am thankful to Grover sir for guiding us and in helping in inviting Dr. Manish too. Dr. Manish, please continue.
Dr. Manish has just had his lunch and he's yet to take a round and come back at 7 a.m. again tomorrow. So we very quickly will listen to him.
We are eagerly waiting to see his videos.
Nowadays, most busy are the ENT surgeons than anything else.
Can you see the screen, sir?
We can see. Please share it.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah, we can see.
Yes.
Okay, so I have a lot of rats rumbling in my stomach. That's absolutely true. So go on for the a few. I mean, it was really educated. In spite of everything that I might be feeling frustrated about time, but all the speakers. I've been working with Dr. Grover's team, him, Dr. Shalu Bageja. We have all been working ground zero, but still there were so many things to learn from the orbital perspective. I'm really thankful. And then last, the neurosurgeon. Obviously, the neurosurgeon stays on the top of everybody, so he has to take the time and do this thing. So in ENT perspective, there is nothing really that I would like to really tell otherwise. I am just running through all these things which already you have been working on this thing. But of course, we can definitely talk about radiology, and even the most important thing is, if you are having an MR better than a CT scan, the first take-home message that I have always realized, it has been a realization to me, that with the symptoms that already have been taken, do not take radiological symptoms even as minimal as these non-seriously. Now in this, if you see, there is a radiologist who definitely tells the more things. As a clinician, you would perhaps see a mucosal thickening, but a radiologist would also point out to the increased bulk in the pterygopalatine, sphenopalatine foramen, and also the increased edema in the pterygopalatine fossa. But and these are the sinister signs of mucormycosis. We must not forget that mucormycosis is a disease which causes microthrombi of the arteries, and therefore we would sometimes like to diagnose the disease by the absence of some vital radiological signs like T2 division images, and rather than more appearance of the images as such. So even having said so, periodical serial MRI and serial this CT scan imaging can still be helpful, because they keep on showing how the disease is progressing, especially after you have operated, and then later on you want to see whether it is spreading into the intracranial regions, the cavernous sinus, carotid artery invasion. So serial MRI, I find, is even more helpful. and sometimes we do also get the carotid angiography in certain cases where there is a possibility of infarcts happening due to the occlusion of the either the internal carotid artery as the end thing or the arteries of the middle cerebral and all those arteries on the back forming the posterior circulation also in certain cases middle and posterior. So MRI angiography has been done in a few cases, especially when you want to see areas where their revascularization at all can be attempted in intracranially bad cases. Other than that, I would like to come straight away to this fact that an ENT surgeon's work starts after the important eye surgeons or any clinician's observation and prompt nasal collection. It's very important to have a proper nasal collection. We always forget, and there are two ways by which we can send the sample. One is a KOH fungal smear with a fungal culture, and the other one is a biopsy. So I always see to it that when the nasal collection is done, it is done in the most atraumatic way. For example, if you see inside the nasal cavity with the endoscope, do you see this blackening? Many residents would try to take a biopsy from this, but it has to be taken, if possible, from this area where you can also recognize some fungal hyphae now regenerating. But this area will take time for the microbiologists to dissolve and see. This will, they will take hardly a minute to do the fungal culture reporting. So we find that directing residents who are at the forefront many times to take the biopsies, it is always helpful to take this. And these areas are a little bit more wet. So whenever you ask them to take a blind nasal swab, make sure that the smudgy mucus comes out and not some dried up clot, because that will not show too much of this thing. Best is not to even add saline in this thing, because microbiologists hate to see a sample totally dissolved in saline, and then they find it very difficult to find the hyphae, because the aseptate hyphae are very, very fragile to hydrolysis. So try to send them as early as possible without any preservatives, and with the forceps also that you use, they should not crush the sample. So then you will definitely get, these are the images that recently were shared by our microbiologists, and they grew the fungal cultures, mucus, and you can get some really good samples if you're doing them well. Of course, there's a multidisciplinary team, and we have all these. I place a great importance on these physicians, because they are the ones who help the patient survive a long run. We have already discussed the stages. These are the stages that we also follow. And a little bit of our own thing that we do, that we recommend also, the treatment by the way of staging. And if there is a recommendation, like that's a very limited one, like in stage one, we do take emphasis on fast local debridement, then followed by the antifungals. Of course, they have to follow. In today's time, when they are antifungal, like amphotericin has totally disappeared from the market, we are really emphasizing that the patient is operated on the day of admission, within hours of admission, and that's really improving the rate of salvage in patients. Of course, when stage 2 and stage 3 comes in, the ophthalmologists are taking a huge important role in the thing, where we have to know whether later on the orbital areas need to be injected, what is the way to go about it. And but of course, as sir had pointed out, Dr. Saab, in the earlier talk, that stage 2, stage 3 in our, this thing is almost always entirely taken care by the ENT surgeon. Then of course, later on, we have to go for, we have decided, we have also classified in our own classification a little bit more of an added space, that is a lower extension. That is extra nasal spread into the pterygomaxillary fossa, nasopharynx, and because of that, we have included this in stage 4, because this is a real difficult stage to treat the maxillary artery, foramen rotundum, and laterally into the infratemporal fossa. We have vital structures where it's difficult to follow the disease, but it is where the storehouse of the disease may be, and then from the behind it can go through the foramen ovale into the midbrain and form an extra way of spreading. So we have found late spread through these areas. So this stage we have added in the whole system. And along with that, of course, therefore the stage 5 becomes with loss of vision in our case, and intracranial involvement and gross involvement, all these things where we have poor prognostic factors then. These are surgical stagings. We know about the definitive therapy. There's just wanted to show in our surgical experience how we go about these surgeries. Like when you do an endoscopy, this is an on-table surgery done just yesterday. This is how we go inside. The first thing that you see inside is the fungal invading badly. See the hyphae coming in, and that was the middle turbinate. Now that you can see behind that is fresh invasive disease coming into the maxillary sinus. We are opening this sinus with a microdebrider. This is a complete showing you the microdebrider at work, and it's now opening the maxillary sinus. As you can see, you see the pus under compression just on the roof of it here. This roof is all the lamina papyracea above that. So this is from where sometimes there's a direct contiguous spread even from the maxillary sinus. And you have to really widen this area. Usually in normal fest surgery, you do not widen these areas that much. Then going posteriorly further, after doing this, you have a situation where you take the debrider up and then you start opening. This is the middle terminate on the side. And then you start opening these areas, the bulla arthrodalis. And then further on, if you have to open the pre-maxillary space, this is a new thing that you have to do. It's called a Denker's modification. You open the maxillary anterior wall, because many times this disease is destroying the cheek, many a times the anterior wall, which cannot be dealt with an endoscopic surgery. But we have modified this technique and we are breaking the piriform sinus first. Then we are going further. This is the sphenoid sinus from where the disease is removed. And this is where the pterygopalatine fossa starts. You are removing the disease from there also. And I'm trying to be as fast as possible. We are now slowly working our way up from the maxillary sinus in the pterygopalatine fossa, the back wall of the maxillary sinus. You can see the pus also coming out of the maxillary sinus. This is the pterygopalatine fossa endoscopically, but it is... See, it was a small little piece that you saw as a one of the sphenopalatine nerves. But when you go into this, these are the pterygoid muscles, and you release the pus from here, it gives a great deal of this thing. These are the maxillary nerve and the artery going together over the pterygoid muscles. And here you see the bubbled up necrotic thing going on. This is all behind the maxillary. This is part of extra maxillary approach, and see how it under pressure it comes on. And these patients are relieved greatly when you do an endoscopic surgery in this thing, in these patients. Of course, you carefully debride the fat of the maxillary infratemporal face. You can just see the maxillary artery. It is thrombosed just on the top of it. But we are eating up all the necrosed fat, and it's really a debulking surgery. At this moment of time, you cannot go beyond the foramen ovale on the back of it. Foramen rotundum on the back of it. But all the fat that you can debride, that really greatly helps these kind of patients. In the end, I'll jump this now, because this is the of importance to the eye people. I have made the lamina fully deskeletonized and given a cut inside the periorbita of the lamina. Once giving the cut, we carefully put a ball probe inside. This is a patient with a severe proptosis, and there was disease in the medial compartment. So we put this thing and see the pus coming out along with the fat. See the pus drilling out, it's trickling out. And these patients do have, these are the candidates. This patient had a 6x36 vision, and after the surgery, immediately his vision improved to 6x12. So sometimes these, and we just keep the fat prolapse inside for the rest of the time. So I don't have too much to say, but early widespread endoscopic debridement, this can be required from both the places. I will not talk about orbital excentration because there is going to be talked furthermore. There is external debridement in facial areas, but there's poor prognosis and you need plastic surgery, and multiple stages may be planned over 4 to 6 weeks. We have not even reached the stage in this pandemic, but I'm sure we'll have more heavy work in the later part of this pandemic. So this is fortunately one of the patients who has healed. I'll not run the video. It's a beautiful video, but this is the opening of the whole sphenoid sinus. You can see the part of the optic chiasma and the carotid recess. And after this, I'll think, okay, this is the data that we were collecting. This is really not the previous of the current epidemic, but this is of the last one. And this is the ones that we did in the first wave, actually, more than 16 surgical cases. But this is what we reported last time in December, and we ultimately landed up tackling around 42 cases even in the first wave. So it's a lot to learn still, and but it's a winning losing battle. We are trying our best, and we are also learning from each other. A lot of projects going on in the hospital, Dr. Grover, and the critical care people. And at the end, I would just like to thank our team of still the young people, our chairman, Dr. Rana, who has been instrumental in getting these mucor patients into the hospital. We are trying our best to help them. And he is the pillar of strength. There are more than 85 patients, as sir put it, currently, and have still to go and take a round. So I'll take a bow now. Thank you.
Thank you, Manish. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Manish, for saving so many life and eyesight of the patients. And thank you. Because of you, we could see inside the nose and nasal sinus is what this fungus is causing damage, how much pus is there. Yes. And we can know what a great job you people are doing now. Thank you,
Manish. Manish is doing a superb job. He's handling the bulk of our work. And I would like you to, whatever questions you have, please ask him now so that he can go for his round.
I will really request that.
Yeah. A special invite is, have you anything to ask to doctor?
Dr. Atul is already treating some of the mucormycosis cases and he wished to ask some question. Dr. Atul?
Hello, sir.
Ask your question about whatever you have with Dr.
Sir, I'm working as a senior resident in AIIMS Rishikesh right now. And sir, what is, are you giving amphotericin wash during the surgery, like after the surgery, the sinus, is it washed with amphotericin or do you give a packing with amphotericin?
But I tell you, amphotericin is in such a short supply that each and every milligram of amphotericin, I'd rather like to put in the IV veins at this moment of time rather than, doing unsubstantiated things. We have been doing it in the past. But I think we must not consider that an anti, just like we don't like to use antibiotics as antiseptics. I also think that an antifungal need not be a good antiseptic for fungal infection. So I'll rather not do it. However, fungals do work differently. And when you come to see the intraorbital injections, they have a definitive role. But I think I've been using fungi, these fungisome gels and all in cavities and all. It does give you a relief. But believe me, relief of necrotic areas and a proper wash of the cavity. Saline is as good as any thing in the world. And if you can clean your cavities well, which we are actually frankly not able to do due to the sheer bulk, if a patient is made to wash the nose like a neti with a sterile water and saline, that is much more better for the inside healing than actually medicines put in it. That's what I would say.
Dr. Manish, if my amphotericin is not available, do we not have any alternative for it?
Of course, we have an alternative. We are other next stage studies would definitely point out to the use of posaconazoles, and even now the ICMR has approved this itraconazole as a therapy, emergency therapy for mucormycosis. I had a webinar with Dr. Chakravarti just 2 days ago, and can it this itraconazole in a high dose, like 400 milligram 2 times a day, can be used as a third alternative to even amphotericin and then posaconazole. We are heavily relying on posaconazole these days to work for us, but of course because not every patient is able to receive amphotericin, and certainly not the 5 to 10 milligram per kg body weight which we want the patient to have.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, when we are short of the supply of amphotericin B, so there is a medication antifungal which we use, caspofugin. So can it be used as an IV antibiotic for a substitute for amphotericin B?
So we have to be very careful in one thing, knowing that these mycoses work on the principle of competitive inhibition. There will be breakthrough fungal infections if you are not careful about the antifungal that you are giving. If you are not giving a targeted antifungal and trying to sort the problem with a broad spectrum antifungal, you will have breakthrough mucus, which are very common in ICU infections. So there is no prophylaxis, there is no antifungal, because caspofungin is proven for aspergillosis and not for mucormycosis. So if you try to make it work for mucor, you will have a problem. But yes, isavuconazole has been recently approved. It's an expensive drug and we have been using it from patients.
Okay, sir. There is one question that from how we get the Sir Ganga Ram Hospital guideline.
Sorry.
How can we get the Sir Ganga Ram Hospital guideline which you are showing?
Dr. Grover represents the Sir Ganga Ram guideline for everything. The guideline. Whatever happens is through him.
Thank you. Thank you, Manish. Thank you, Dr. Manish. Thank you, Manish. You have given your time. Now you can go and have a round.
Thanks, Manish.
Your dinner. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Lunch.
Yeah, lunch. Sorry.
Grover, sir,
Dr. is here.
Sir, Ashok Rai, sir, having another meeting, so he left. So,
Dr. Grover, sir, I have a question for you.
Yes.
Is this disease contagious? What precaution a resident should take when he is touching the patient?
No, fortunately.
Asked by Dr. Amrasa.
Fortunately, this condition is not contagious. This is an organism which is present all around us in the air. And it is therefore almost always in your nose as well. It is only a reduced immunity and all the alterations that are taking place because of diabetes, because of steroids, because of alteration in the mucosa, which are making it to cause a disease. So it is not a contagious disease. You are not required to take any additional precautions from that point of view. But we have only suggested that those who are immunosuppressed or those who are post-COVID should use masks, because they can reduce the coming in of the spores into their system. And also, if they use a drop like a saline drop twice a day and keep their nasal mucosa wet, that would reduce the chances of the spores being transmitted.
So you have made all of us afraid that they are in our nose already there.
Yes, they are everywhere in the environment.
As you breathe.
Dr. Santosh, there is a question for you from Dr. Milind. What is the exact indication for exantation?
Well, exact indication for exantation is diffuse orbital disease, ideally when vision is lost, and if it is progressive following optimal sinus surgery and 72 hours of systemic antifungals. Full dose amphotericin B. So that is when you would indicate orbital exantation.
But the second question was, we should wait for the PL negative?
I already answered. PL negative, you don't have to wait for it. If the disease is progressive and if you feel that doing orbital exantation can help patient save his life, then you should go ahead irrespective of vision.
Santosh has said it beautifully. He has covered it so wonderfully in his talk. The only thing that radiologists keep telling us is that as long as the tissues, all the tissues that you see show contrast enhancement and are vascular, they would be susceptible to therapy reaching there, your systemic intravenous therapy reaching there, and you would have less reason to do an excentration. But the moment they find that there is more dead and necrotic tissue, which is not enhancing, which is lying in the orbit, then that becomes the indication for debulking and for going ahead. Sometimes when we find that the disease is medial, we depend on, especially those cases where the vision is present, we depend on the ENT surgeon to do a breaking of the ethmoid bone and cutting of the periosteum and draining off the material from the medial side, so that we are able to postpone the excentration by the intervention of the ENT surgeon combined with the use of our retrobulbar amphotericin B.
Okay, sir. Another question is from Dr. Kirti Jain, sir. She wished to ask, what are the causes for the central lateral artery occlusion of the surgical debridement of mucormycosis?
It is not after surgical debridement that CRAO happens. CRAO is a part and parcel of the process of mucormycosis. It is the fungal embolus that gets into the central retinal artery or thrombosis. It can occur because of COVID also. In patients who have co-infection, concurrent COVID as well as mucormycosis, it could be either because of COVID itself that the patient has CRAO, which is a thrombotic phenomena, or by mucormycosis.
Sir, another question from Dr. Lokesh. He want to ask, what will be the precaution a doctor should take while going round in the COVID negative mucormycosis ward?
It's already answered. It's not contagious.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question for Santosh sir. Good evening, sir. Sir, according to the proposed ROCM staging, if we are planning to institute retrobulbar amphotericin, so what stage should we exactly be administering it? Once it's stage 3, in what stage?
Yeah, 3A is when you start. See, it can be administered before paranasal sinus surgery, during paranasal sinus surgery, and after paranasal sinus surgery. If the patient is not fit for paranasal sinus surgery yet, something that you can readily do is intraorbital amphotericin to the medial orbit, because medial orbit is the first way involved. During surgery, of course, if you're not doing a medial orbital decompression, like Dr. Grover mentioned, you're not touching the lamina papyrusia, patient yet has a inferomedial orbital invasion, you haven't debulked it from the paranasal sinus side, the nasal side, then you can inject. And post-operative, again, if the patient has residual disease and if the patient is progressing, again, you inject. So it can be used at any stage.
Sir, I have a question for Shubha, ma'am.
Yes, Manotra, please ask.
Ma'am, actually, I am working in a rural center as a medical officer in ophthalmology in a district hospital. Ma'am, we don't have those facilities of a CT and an MRI. Mostly, most of our diagnoses are clinically based. Ma'am, the nearest CT or MRI machine is approximately 70 to 80 kilometers apart from us. So, ma'am, on the first suspicion, we try to start an amphotericin. And, ma'am, majority of the patients what we get are neglected, old, uneducated. And they are not willing to go to the higher center, or they are willing to even die in the same center on the hospital they are based, or they are admitted. So, ma'am, what could we do at the level of a district hospital so that we could help the community?
Well, as they are all already saying that just clinical suspicion, you should start with the treatment. So, do you have antifungals over there?
Ma'am, we have amphotericin, but that is also in a short supply.
Is it ribosomal or is it liposomal?
It's liposomal, sir.
So that's a good thing. Amphotericin B acts very well. So at least you can start that and give retrobulbar amphotericin, as I told you, on the clinical suspicion. Yes, yeah. If vision is there to the patient and the patient has all the signs, then you can go for retrobulbar injections as well as IV antifungals. Yeah, in early cases, it can definitely help.
Okay. Then after that also, if you have given amphotericin, what are the chances of mortality?
Late cases, if more progression and not giving any treatment, so definitely the patient will succumb. Yes. Mortality is very high, like 60 to 90% if you're not treating the cases.
So, Sanem, if with amphotericin B, if some sinus debridement can be done, those two things will go a long way in reducing the mortality. One, of course, we've spoken about the retrobulbar injections, but yes, intravenous therapy and the sinus debridement, those are the mainstay. If you can somehow have somebody do a sinus debridement, yes, nearest possible person, then you improve the chances of survival.
And this is very common with rural things because of unhygienic conditions and more so with the farmers, basically. So we are also seeing many patients coming from the rural side.
And second thing, your aim should be to motivate them to refer them. Even we are referring them patient 150 km away from our place to AIIMS Rishikesh from this Dr. Atul, that boy is working there. We are referring them because we do not have the amphotericin B with us, neither any antifungal. So, because this is given directly to the government hospitals.
Yes.
So, you should try to motivate the patient to go, because you cannot save patient at your place because he is not ENT surgeon, no debridement. And amphotericin B, I don't think it will be available in plenty in your place. Next question by any specialist.
So, one question to the entire panel, sir. Sir, there were some reports of adding methylene blue into the humidifier water.
Yes.
And some reports are there, sir. So, anybody has any input on that?
Santosh, I want to ask from you.
No evidence was there available, but some people are practicing it in India. So
it is empiric.
Dr. Santosh, actually, in many groups, I am part of many groups, methylene blue is propagating like anything for COVID and for this. I want to special this question from you, which he asked.
We have no evidence, sir. We have no evidence.
Have you ever tried it?
That's a special gem from the WhatsApp University.
Actually,
the microbiologists insist that if you are giving oxygen through the humidifier, spores cannot be transmitted. What they are very clear is that yeast-like fungi can come or bacteria can come if the fluid is contaminated, but spores are not transmissible through a humidifier. That they are very categorical on that. If you talk to any microbiologist or any mycologist, so I think that part, that misgiving is probably not justified. And methylene blue probably then has no role.
Even doctor, sir, on COVID-19?
COVID-19, any patient, the fungus, the transmission of spores is not likely.
No, if it's not the fungus, only and viral, COVID-19, methylene blue has any role?
I have no clue. Again, I have also seen the videos and I've also heard from WhatsApp.
I think Santosh sir already mentioned that there is no clue or documented study. So,
Dr. Santosh, one question to you. As ENT Dr. Manish has told that itraconazole they are using as an alternate drug. What is your suggestion for the alternate drug to amphotericin B?
Alternate drug, the best proven alternate drug to amphotericin B is posaconazole. It has a role and it's been proven already in earlier studies. Isavuconazole is a relatively new drug and that also role has been proven. Whereas, itraconazole in a higher dose seems to work, but if no other drug is available, if the first three choices are not available, then you can go for itraconazole.
And what about prophylactic posaconazole? You have told prophylactic
posaconazole. Prophylactic posaconazole is routinely given in patients who have had bone marrow transplantation and have consistently low counts. They have a high risk of fungal infection. So it is given in that subgroup of patients or patients who have end-stage leukemia where they have to be protected from secondary fungal infection. To improve the quality of life, it is given. It has not been tried in the situation of COVID and mucormycosis. Okay. So, extrapolating the evidence that we have in hematological malignancies and bone marrow transplant patients, it has been proposed as in high-risk patients. And the definition of high-risk is more than 3 weeks of mechanical ventilation.
We should probably not yet think of making it a recommendation because we would then be depriving those who could otherwise get posaconazole as a therapeutic thing. So at this moment, till the availability is short, we should probably not mention it as an alternative. for prevention.
Dr. Abhishek, Dr. Surbhi, you want to ask any question?
So very well explained by all doctors, Dr. Santosh, Dr. Shubha. All doubts are already in curve.
Okay. Abhishek?
Sir, I just wanted to ask, sir, have you found any relation between zinc, excessive use of zinc and mucormycosis?
This is also going on in WhatsApp nowadays. What? Excessive zinc is a cause of the mucormycosis. Can be called that.
Theoretically, it is a possibility because zinc enhances certain transcription factors, and because of which there is a higher virulence in the fungus and higher penetrability into tissues. But practically, we are still not sure.
Dr. Santosh, in your video, in your presentation, you have showed that even in the at home, patients who are at home, you are not taking any oxygen, young patient, they are getting this virus, this fungus. What can be the cause in them?
Yeah, the alternative mechanism is that this COVID causes necrosis of the mucosa, right? So there is COVID-related mucosal necrosis that is predisposed to infection by fungus. So necrotic mucosa in the nose already gets infected by the fungus, although they are immunocompetent, since that mucosa is necrotic. Immunity does not come much into play. Systemic immunity does not come into play in the mucosa when the mucosa is infected, which is already necrosed, and that progresses. That is the proposed hypothesis for young individuals who have not been treated with steroids, who are home cared, developing mucor. But the number is not so high. This is one odd case that are coming, but patients are coming in their 30s and 35-year-olds, non-diabetics. But it is possible that when they had COVID, they had temporarily become diabetic. COVID itself is diabetogenic.
That's true.
But they may not have checked their blood sugar because they were home care. Second possibility is that they may have used steroids empirically by themselves. Many patients are treating themselves, self-medicating themselves with steroids.
So just as Santosh said, we have in our group some who were non-diabetics but were hyperglycemic, induced by steroids, or they must maybe pre-diabetics who have become new diabetics with the steroid use. So I think that is one factor. But what we've noticed is that many of these who don't have diabetes or who did not have a history of use of steroids have a very mild disease and have responded well. So they are generally not in the admitted patients. In our admitted patients, in this series, nearly 100% are either those who are diabetics or who had hyperglycemia, newly induced hyperglycemia. So.
Dr. Grover, sir, what is your advice for the patients who are recovering from the COVID to take care that they do not get the disease, about the care of the nose?
I think one very important thing Dr. Santosh mentioned was that they should all be aware that for the next 6 weeks at least that we are recommending, they should be fully cognizant of the complications that can start, how they start and what symptoms they should be aware of. That is the most important thing, to present early. They should be aware of all these things. Of course, for prevention, it has been suggested that they should have the least possible exposure to the external environmental pollutants or dust particles. So they should be using a good mask even after their COVID. And it has been recommended that they can use nasal drops, even simple saline twice a day, which will reduce the probability of being exposed to the spores.
Any role of reusing of mask or wet mask in spreading this mucormycosis?
Not really demonstrated. Again, because it is in the air all around us. See, the difference what we have is we are a tropical country. Our air quality index is 150 or above at the times of lockdown. I was in London and the air quality index was 2 on the first day, it was 1 on the next day. It is considered a calamity in Melbourne when it goes above 25. So we are living in a different kind of climate. We get a lot more fungal corneal ulcers than anybody else in the world does. So that is one reason why we may be more predisposed. There are a lot of things we still don't know, but therefore we don't really know how to prevent it fully. We really have to sort it out ourselves as to why we get so many more cases after our COVID epidemic. They hardly reported 11 cases in the US in the first wave, in the huge first part of the pandemic that they had. Say up to May 13 in the review that has been published now, all cases published up to May 13, out of 101 cases, 82 or something were from India. So only 19 from all around the world. And what I've spoken to our neighbors in Bangladesh, in Nepal and Pakistan, they've had only a handful of cases. So we have to work it out ourselves. As to, they probably have not had so many cases, but one would have expected that being in a similar environment, they would also be getting cases as many, but they have only had a handful of two or three or one or two cases so far. And it's not happened in Southeast Asia. It has not happened in other parts of the tropical world. So we really have to sort out. Industrial oxygen has, it certainly can be contaminated. We all know that. And that it is not prepared with the same precautions, with the same container, so it can contain contaminants. But again, if the oxygen is taken through the proper route, through the regulator, which always has a chamber for fluid, this pose should not get transmitted through that. So we really have to work out what's going wrong in our country.
Thank you, sir.
And as another question to SS, sir. Sir, is any role of steaming in increasing or decreasing the fungal?
Steaming, well, I mean, it only hydrates the mucosas. It should have a potentially good role. Steaming should not increase colonization.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Grover, sir. Thank you,
Dr. Questions for the moderator, Ling?
Yeah.
Because Dr. Arthi, you can go ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I have a question for the panel. is there I had few questions, but in interest of time, I'll just ask one. Is there any correlation between vaccination and incidence of mucormycosis? So we've noticed that from few states, the incidence is less, like especially Kerala and southern part of India. So is there any correlation between vaccination and the incidence?
Not studied. It will happen in the southern part of India. Mucormycosis always follows the downward trend of COVID infection. So in Delhi, for example, COVID is on the decline, mucor is on the rise. In other states, mucor it will follow when the COVID starts declining. So it is a matter of time. Everybody has to face it. But the actual numbers are 8,000 out of nearly, say, you know, mucor is something that data cannot suppress. Patient has to go to a medical care facility when he or she has mucor. COVID can data be suppressed, it can be under testing, many patients can be asymptomatic. So at least if you take the COVID numbers as real, mucor numbers also as real, it is 1 in 5,000 patients who are RT-PCR positive are getting mucormycosis. It is extremely rare, but the country is so large and the number is so large that 8,000 adds up into a big, you know, series. And it is very fearsome because of the ferocity of the disease.
So, Grover sir, you are treating like let's say 100 patients as of now. So, how many of them are vaccinated against COVID?
We haven't really collated that data yet. But this is true that those who are vaccinated are getting less severe disease. We had 32 vaccinated doctors who got the infection altogether when the new variant was not known, 117.2. And they have all been detected to have 117.2. So this is true that the number of people who are getting manifest symptoms is fairly high in those who've been vaccinated. But since they are protected from very severe disease, where there would be less use of steroids, where there would be less likelihood of hyperglycemia or lowered immunity, they are not getting hospitalized that often. So it is likely that those who are vaccinated will be protected from mucormycosis as well to a certain level.
Another question is for the Shubha ma'am. How to store the reconstituted amphotericin B? Just last question.
What is that? I didn't get it.
How to store the reconstituted amphotericin B?
How to?
Store.
Store.
Store it.
Okay, we can store at 4 degrees centigrade in the fridge. It is not supposed to freeze, but store at 4 degrees.
And I wrap it with a brown paper. Basically, it should not get exposed to light.
Yeah. And I wanted to say around about 80 patients in my hospital, and from those, 6 of them have been like vaccinated, post-vaccinated patients.
And so, any special consent is taken before from the patient if you are giving them stored amphotericin B as compared to fresh?
No, nothing.
Off-label use. No, just an off-label consent. It's an off-label use. So you simply have to take an off-label consent like you take for anti-VEGF.
Thank you,
sir. Yeah. When Dr. Grover sir and Dr. Santosh are there, they are endless discussion because questions and answers are coming and going on, but it is dinner time for all of you.
Then,
in the interest of time, we will try to wind up.
Thanks to them, Dr. Grover sir, as always, supporting us, Dr. Santosh, on very short notice, he joined us, Dr. Shubha, Dr. Ravi and Dr. Manjal already left here. So thanks, big thanks to all of you. Yes, Yanti.
Hand over to you. This
program for the Santosh sir, and he at 12 p.m. at midnight, and he immediately replied me that you go ahead and plan your team. I am available on such and such a time. I am really unable to say thanks, sir, to you and Grover sir for whatever the times we ask for our PGs, you both are available.
Dr. Santosh, and Dr. Ravi, I have just left because he was the Vice President IMA, All India. He has been very useful for us in getting all the information. Guidelines for making this treatment of this disease, you can make with the coordination with the IMA, National IMA.
Sure.
Okay. Dr. Arthi, please.
Dr. Ravi can help us.
Dr. Arthi, please proceed.
Yes, sir. So we all agree that conducting this webinar was need of the time. I, Dr. Arthi, on behalf of Team SSTC and PG Examination Forum, would like to propose hearty vote of thanks to Dr. Ashok Rai, sir, Dr. Grover, Dr. Santosh Unnavar, sir, Dr. Shubha, ma'am, Dr. Ravi, sir, Dr. Manish, who took their valuable time of their busy schedule and gave their valuable inputs. Our special invitees and audience for making this session so interesting and interactive. Sun Pharma for all their technical support. Thank you, Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir, and Dr. Satanshu, sir, for creating this platform, PG Examination Forum, for residents, which is actually a family of 2,500 members now, including students and teachers. So I would like to thank all the team for this wonderful evening. And I suggest all the residents to take advantage of this platform for not only clearing their exams, but getting their ophthalmology strong. So stay safe, stay healthy. That's it from my end. Over to you, Deepak, sir.
Mr. Deepak Dameja is here from the Sun Pharma. Deepak ji, you wish to say anything?
Proud privilege to be associated with your society, sir. But actually, I am really seeing that amount of effort Santosh Unnavar sir, Dr. Grover sir has been putting last so many days. So many people are asking for them to come over the stage and help increase and expand the understanding about the disease and how to go about managing this. Because sir was there in the program yesterday also, almost 3 hours. Every day they are in the program, one or the other. Really, hats off to you because treating patients on one side and creating awareness amongst your fellow colleagues to deal with this menace. It's absolutely hats off to all of you, sir. Thank you so very much for giving us an opportunity to expand this education. Thank you very much, Shubha, madam. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Ashok Rai, sir. Thank you, Ravi, sir. Thank you very much, Manish Munjal, sir. As well as SSTC Society, Sir Satanshu Mathur, sir. And Deepak Mishra, sir, for giving us this opportunity to be associated with you. And really hope that whatever way you are trying to help the people, you can deal with the situation in much perfect manner over a period of time. Hopefully, amphotericin B, which has been asked for, probably the government is also taking an intervention that the supply is increased because most of the companies are increasing their production also. Probably over a period of next 1 month's time, you may see that there would be a significant improvement in the production also of amphotericin B. So So thanks for giving an opportunity once again, Deepak sir. Thanks a lot. And
industry has a huge role to play at this time. You must augment the supplies in all ways possible. You are saving lives, literally, by the amount of drugs that you can produce.
In fact, Sun Pharma can play a role because their cancer kind of drug list has amphotericin included, but you have stopped producing it. I don't know why. It is in the list of your cancer division drugs.
I agree with you, sir. Actually, what happened, even amphotericin B, just 3 months back also, they were producing a batch of close to around 2,000 vials in one batch. And that was not getting consumed over a period of even 4 to 6 months time. Suddenly, because of this complication of Nucaran, where it has been now indicated as a prime drug, suddenly the consumption has gone so high. Almost 7 companies are currently manufacturing. Government has given the approval to 5 more companies to manufacture this. And the companies are also trying to increase their capacity to improve the production of the product. But probably, I think, over a period of next 1 month, 1.5 months time, you will see that there will be definitely increased production of the products.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Bhagesh, sir, for all the IT support.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Bhagesh, sir, make us offline.
Thank you. Thank you very much.